Welcome to EPG Pathshala. My name is Parimala Kulkarni. I teach in the Department of English in Osmania University, Hyderabad. In today's presentation, we will look at Unit 5, which is drama of the paper African Writing and Caribbean Writing in English. Module 32, which is called F.O. Sutherland's play, The Marriage of Anansiwa. First, we will begin by looking at F.O. Sutherland, the author, her works, some of the themes and major concerns in her works, and then we are going to focus on the play, The Marriage of Anansiwa, and analyze the play. F.O. Sutherland was a pioneer of African theatre, a prominent Ghanaian playwright. She was a poet, a producer. She was also a children's author, teacher, research scholar, and social worker. So she played many roles. She is best known as a dramatist though, and her work is informed by a vision of a better society which she believed could be established through imparting suitable cultural education, and she worked a lot towards this. She is recognized as one of Ghana's dynamic voices in employing traditional theatre for promoting social change. As a creative thinker and activist, she used her talents and skills in educating the future generation. Now let us take a look at a few biographical details of F.O. Sutherland. She was born in Akan, Ghana. Sutherland was exposed to two dichotomous cultures, that of Africa as well as Europe, which proved to be an advantage to her. She was first educated at Ghana and then later at England. Then she came back to Ghana after Ghana's independence in the year 1952. She started researching on the African heritage and the rich culture. Sutherland was one of the foremost intellectuals of Ghana and contributed a lot in the rebuilding of the Ghanaian nation after independence. Sutherland co-founded the Ghana Society of Writers in 1957. She also established the literary magazine named Okeme in the year 1961. In 1958, Sutherland established the Ghana Experimental Theatre in Accra, and in 1960, she received funding from the US Rockefeller Foundation and Arts Council of Ghana, and later this theatre became the Ghana Drama Studio. Initially, she established the drama studio as a workshop for children's writers, but it soon became a training ground for Ghanaian playwrights, which proved to be an outlet for creative new writers. And when Ama Atta Edu, another prominent Ghanaian playwright, studied drama at the University of Ghana, she mentored Ama Atta Edu. Besides, Sutherland held a number of academic and administrative and governmental positions in Ghana. After her retirement from the university, she was the foundation member and later chairperson of the Ghana National Commission on Children. In the 1990s, after her retirement from public service, she initiated the MOFRA Foundation. MOFRA in Akan means children, a registered non-profit organization which was dedicated to enriching the cultural life of children in Ghana. Next, Sutherland mooted the idea of the PANAFEST movement, which was a proposal for the Pan-African Historical Theatre Festival. This was her artistic vision for the African peoples. This shows her commitment to link the African people with that of the diasporic Africans in other countries. She was also instrumental in establishing the Dubois Foundation, Center for Pan-African Culture. A leading Ghanaian writer, Sutherland is one of the well-known voices of Africa. She wrote both in Akan as well as in English. She has written several articles, essays, a novel, even a short biography. She has also written plays for children. But it is her plays which have brought her lasting acclaim. Sutherland began writing her short stories, but she realized that drama or theatre would have a lasting impact on the Ghanaian public, as most of these people were illiterate. Therefore, she focused on developing drama and she started researching into the native drama which had been there before independence. She has three major plays to her credit: Foriva, written in 1962, Edufa in 1967, and The Marriage of Anansiva in 1967, which we will be looking at in this module. Foriva, Sutherland's first major play, originally appeared as an allegorical short story. It's based on a folk tale where the African mothers caution their daughters from unknown handsome men, with a message that young women who break community rules are going to be punished and they're going to face disaster. But Sutherland transforms the story to convey a positive message. So Foriva was considered a metaphor for Ghana itself, and she focused on bringing in national unity despite differences in gender, ethnicity or ideology. Another theme in this play is the combining of the old and new, where Sutherland tries to bring or build a bridge between tradition and modernity. Foriva also emphasizes the role of women in the Ghanaian society and contributing towards the development of the Ghanaian culture and society. Sutherland's second play, Edufa, one of Sutherland's most acclaimed plays, is based on the Greek play Alcestis, written by Euripides. In this story, Euripides presents the story of Alcestis, the wife of Admetus, who sacrifices her life in order to bring back her husband from the dead. In Edufa, Sutherland adapts this myth and locates it in an African setting. And unlike in Euripides' play, where the wife is restored to life, Sutherland's play is a tragedy, where giving up traditional values in favor of contemporary materialism brings about the downfall of Edufa. So Sutherland explores the vulnerability of a man in his quest to maintain his societal position and the loss of a dear one in order to maintain his status. The play focuses on Edufa's individualistic self-centeredness in contrast to the other characters who are more into traditional and communal ways. Now let us take a look at some of the themes and concerns in her plays. Sutherland played a key role, as I said earlier, in modern Ghanaian theatre, and through her research helped in finding the African way of life, discovered the need for reviving the rich African traditions. This influenced the thematic concerns in her plays. One of the themes that recurs in her plays is the theme of tradition and modernity. Her plays focus on the alliance of old traditions and new ways. Foriva's central theme, for example, is to bring about a spirit of openness to new ideas while reinforcing the affirmative traditional values. In Edufa, the westernized man who trades traditional values in favor of contemporary capitalist greed and vanity faces tragedy. In the play that we are going to consider a little later, in Marriage of Anansiva, Sutherland combines the traditional folktale conventions with modern dramatic techniques. So her plays focus on bridging the gap between tradition and modernity in rebuilding a progressive contemporary Ghana. Another major concern of Sutherland in her plays is the role of women. Sutherland challenges the cultural expectations of women in the Ghanaian society, and Foriva places women in the forefront as agents of cultural transformation, development and modernity while continuing to uphold the traditional values. And in Sutherland's Edufa and The Marriage of Anansiva, women's objectification is a matter of concern. Sutherland's plays support a meaningful change in the relationship between men and women. Now let us turn to the text that we are concerned with today, that is Sutherland's play, The Marriage of Anansiva. The Marriage of Anansiva is subtitled A Storytelling Drama. It was published in 1975. This is considered to be Sutherland's most valuable contribution to Ghanaian drama and theatre. It was a comic play. It was published after its productions in Akan and English by three companies in Ghana. Now let us take a look at the background in which this play was written. Sutherland, in her search for an Afrocentric medium of artistic expression, she started to explore the traditional theatrical forms and conventions and discovered that pre-colonial Ghana enjoyed a rich culture of pageantry. In the diverse traditions of all the ethnic groups in Ghana, drama, drumming and dancing were integral to their culture. She used this rich oral tradition of storytelling, rendition of songs, ritual dances and several traditional ceremonies and festivals in her plays. The traditional theater she developed is known as Anansigoro. In Marriage of Anansiwa, Sutherland develops the Akan story, art of storytelling called Anansism, which includes elements such as musical interludes and community participation. Anansism literally means Anansi's stories. It is a term used for both the body of stories told and for the storytelling performance itself. Anansi is the archetypal spider trickster in Akan oral narratives, and Sutherland develops the traditional Akan spider tales into a new dramatic structure, which she calls Anansigoro. In the foreword to the play, she writes about the origin of Anansigoro and the significance of Anansi, a kind of everyman artistically exaggerated and distorted to serve society as a medium for self-examination. In Anansism, which is a community art, the storyteller tells the whole story himself, and musical performances called Bogyo are part of the stories and are performed in the context led by the storyteller. It is a convention for Bogyo to be contributed by the other people present. Sutherland in the foreword says that Bogyo in its traditional concept has been inherited wholesale by Anansigoro. So the play recreates the communal storytelling atmosphere with audience involvement, songs, dance and a storyteller who interacts with both the players as well as the audience. Anansigoro is Sutherland's new theatrical form with emphasis on rhythm, music and dance. Now let us take a look at the summary of the play, The Marriage of Anansisiva. The four-act play centers around George Kwiku Anansi, the famous spider trickster figure of African oral narratives. In the play, he is a crafty modern individual who uses every opportunity to acquire wealth by cunning and fraudulent means. Act 1 sets out Anansi's problem, which is poverty, and how he plans to solve it. Anansi devises a scheme to use his daughter's physical beauty to secure not one but four suitors. He selects four rich chiefs and shows them a photograph of his marriageable daughter. He invites them to formally ask for his daughter's hand in marriage while not informing them that each of them is competing against the three others. He leads each of the four chiefs to believe that he is best suited for his beautiful daughter Anansiwa. Anansiwa unwittingly types the letters that her father dictates, assuring the chiefs of protecting the object of their interest. However, when she realizes that the letters are for securing a husband for her, she protests. She accuses her father of selling her off like some parcel to a customer. But her cunning father calls her ungrateful and reminds her of all suffering that he underwent for her sake, and finally convinces her of the necessity of such a plan and demands her cooperation in ensuring the material well-being of the family. Simultaneously, he also arouses her interest in one of the chiefs, chief, whom he describes as finely built, glowing black, large-eyed, handsome as anything, courageous and famous. In addition, the chief has already given Anansi some money with which to pay Anansiwa's secretarial school fees. Consequently, Anansiwa becomes interested in this chief. So in Act 2, Anansi's scheme is successful. He gets rich. With the gifts received from all the chiefs, he improves his lifestyle considerably, renovates his house and buys new clothes. In Act 3, tension mounts as all the four chiefs are interested in marrying Anansiwa. Each chief chooses a date for the customary marriage, which Sutherland calls the head drink ceremony, a token by which the marriage is legally established. Unfortunately, all the four chiefs choose the same day for the ceremony. Anansi is caught in his own web. He needs to solve the serious problem before it brings him trouble. He finds a solution by getting an answer to feign death, to pretend to be dead. Then he invites his mother Aya, his aunt Ikua, and his friend Christy to the outdooring ceremony for Anansua. He cut short the ceremony and sends back his mother and aunt on the pretext that the enemies have set fire to their cocoa farm in their hometown. In the final act, the message of the unfortunate death of Anansua is conveyed to each suitor. Hearing the news, the chiefs send their condolences along with their gifts. The messengers of the chiefs inadvertently reveal the real intentions and motives behind the chief's decision to marry Anansua. Three out of the four chiefs desire to marry Anansua with an ulterior motive. It is the chief who is chief, through his messenger, reveals that he actually loves Anansua and he is truly interested in marrying her, and he is genuinely saddened by the death of Anansua. And he declares that it is his desire to do for Anansua what a husband does for a wife. Thus, it is the chief who is really sincere in his love for Anansua, even in her death. And Anansua is so overwhelmed by the chief's gesture of affection, concern, generosity and thoughtfulness that he goes into a trance and invokes his ancestors to bring back Anansua to life. He says, "See to it that she returns to life. Wake her. See to it that Anansua awakes and returns to become a bride." And lo, at the invocation, Anansua wakes up as if from a deep sleep and exclaims, "Father, I could hear chief who is chief calling me." The power of love ostensibly triumphs over death, and the play ends on a happy note. Now let us take a look at the characters in the play. Let's begin by looking at the first character around whom the play revolves, that is Anansi. Anansi, the spider trickster figure of the Akan oral narratives, assumes the form of George Kweku Anansi in the play. He is the archetypal trickster. Anansi uses his wits not only to survive but also to gain material wealth. He is pretentious, he condemns wealth, yet in order to prosper, he does not hesitate to auction his human possession, his daughter. He is resourceful, clever and cunning, but he turns an established custom to his advantage. He encourages all the four chiefs to propose to his daughter. He promises them that he will give his daughter to each of them. However, he is cunningly confident that he is not obliged to give his daughter's hand to any one of them until the head drink is sent for Anansua. Yet he panics, revealing his father's concern for the daughter, when all the four chiefs decide to come on the same day to perform the head drink ceremony. However, using his cunning, he successfully spins another spider's web and resolves the issue and saves his daughter, and finally gets his daughter married to the person with whom she has fallen in love with. Anansi is the unbeatable trickster whose success lies in his knowledge of society and human nature. He is so secretive and does not reveal his plan to even those people who are very close to him. He does not hesitate to use his own mother, his aunt, and Christina, the fashionable woman who is interested in getting married to him. He successfully deceives them all and achieves what he wishes to. However, it does not mean that Anansi does not care for his daughter. In spite of using her as his possession to gain material wealth and societal standing, he does care for his daughter. He takes care that she gets the best person, that is the chief, who is wealthy, who is handsome, and who has also a social status. Anansi gambles dangerously, but things in the end work out very well, and he is able to get the best husband for his daughter. We will look at the character of Anansua, the daughter of Anansi. Now, Anansua is Anansi's only daughter, and unlike in the Akan folk tales where Anansi has no daughters, Anansi in the play has a female child, which is very, very significant. Anansiwa is a 20-year beautiful young and educated modern woman who lives with her father. She is an intelligent woman and expresses displeasure at being denied the freedom to choose her own husband. She objects with her father for being sold as a commodity to some old chief with 50 wives. However, when her father speaks of the possibility of a handsome, strong, courageous and famous chief who is chief, her heart starts thumping so fast and she decides to leave it all in her father's hands and trust him. In the end, she is rewarded for believing in her father because among all the four chiefs, it is the chief who is chief who reveals genuine love for her. She may be seen as a submissive person with no will of her own. However, it is significant that she submits to her father's will and allows her to be manipulated only after she is sure about who she is going to marry. So, though it is Anansi who spins the web around her, it is Anansiwa who controls the thread of her father's web. Then we look at Aya. Aya is Anansi's mother. She is a loving mother and a grandmother. She embodies traditional values. She advises her granddaughter that she should look beyond wealth. Her gift for her grandchild is her prayer for Anansiwa to marry a good person with respect for fellow human beings. So she does not give importance to wealth, but it is the human quality which is very, very important for her, and it is that she wishes for her granddaughter. Then we go on to look at the next character, Christina Yamowa. Christina is described as a fashionable young woman. Anansi describes her as worldly wise, a helper and a supporter. She has come from the Institute of Prospective Brides to help Anansi and Anansiwa. She takes care of Anansiwa in preparing her for the outdooring ceremony and tries to win Anansi's favor. She is out to impress Anansi's mother because she herself is interested in marrying Anansi. It is Christy who takes the full responsibility of receiving the chief's messengers and their gifts while Anansi mourns the loss of his only child. She also carefully guards Anansiwa's body, ensuring that no one comes near the body. Then there are many other minor characters, Ekwa, Anansi's aunt, and Aya's sister. She belongs to the older generation, but she understands and accommodates the younger generation. Then you have the couple, Akwasi and Akosia, who perform the bogyo to emphasize the point that the suitor has no claim over the prospective bride until the head drink ceremony is performed. Then we have the storyteller, who is a genial and astute commentator. Then there are the carpenter, the mason, the painter and the postman, who are actually representative of the society and who are also a comment on the society which gives undue importance to wealth and social status. Then we have the four chiefs who are never seen on the stage, but we get to hear about them through their messengers. They're all rich, generous and love flattery. Then another important, though we may not call this person character, is the property man. The property man is someone like a stage manager and not necessarily a character in the play. The job of the property man is to be on the stage and handing over props to the characters in full view of the audience. Next, we will take a look at some of the major themes in the play, The Marriage of Anansiwa. One of the major themes that Sutherland is concerned with in this play is the theme of bride price, marriage and love. The play examines how the tradition of bride price is used by Anansi to exploit suitors to gain material acquisitions. Marriage becomes a kind of auction where the bride is sold to the highest bidder. The play questions the idea of daughter as a human possession, an object, a commodity to be sold in the market of matrimony. The play is also a father's quest for securing the best husband for his daughter. The play's meaning can be found in its climax, where the four chiefs respond to Anansiwa's death. It is only chief who is chief who wins Anansiwa's heart because his love goes beyond customary rituals. So what is of significance is genuine love and total commitment even in the face of death. And it is this love that brings back Anansiwa to life. Then we go on to look at the role of women in contemporary Ghanaian society. The play raises the issue of the role of women in contemporary Ghanaian society. Anansi is clearly in charge of all the women in the play, that is his daughter Anansiwa, his mother Aya, Aunt Ekua, and Christy, a fashionable and educated woman. He manipulates all of them to suit his needs. Aya and Ekua, who are traditional, as well as Anansiwa and Christy, who are modern and urban educated, all fall prey to the wily trickster. However, Anansiwa and Christy support his plans as long as it suits their purpose. Anansiwa hopes to marry the rich and handsome chief and Christy in order to win Anansi himself. But the play can be seen as a critique of a society which views women as being hailed largely due to their beauty and their ability to captivate marriageable men through their physical charm. The play also questions the tradition in which women are marketed around for the benefit of a family or community. This is a major concern that Sutherland examines in her play, The Marriage of Anansiwa. Besides this, there is also the theme of survival, materialism, and consumer culture in post-colonial Ghana. The play focuses on the survival strategies of the impoverished Anansi. He does not have money to pay for the education of his daughter, so he makes plans to pay her fees and look after himself, but he does it through cunning and fraudulent means. He is not doing this just for survival, however, but he is interested in acquiring material wealth and comforts for himself. He craves for the Western-style luxuries like refrigerators, comfortable chairs, invitations to state functions, embassy parties, and going to church in fashionable clothes and give donations to show off wealth. So the materialistic motives of Anansi and the nouveau riche are mocked and ridiculed. The play satirizes the hopes and aspirations of people to get rich by dishonest means. It is also a satire on the contemporary attitude of respecting the rich. For example, the postman starts saluting Anansi only after he acquires wealth, and only the wealthy are invited to state functions. Next, we will take a look at the dramatic techniques used by Sutherland in the play, The Marriage of Anansiwa. The dramatic techniques are the most important contribution that she has made to the African theatre craft. Though the play is structured into four acts in the format of a modern African folk theatre, it comes out of the tradition of the oral narrative performance. It adopts many of the techniques of the oral tradition. First, let us take a look at the first technique, that is the use of the storyteller. The storyteller is central to the play. He relates to the actors on the stage, the players, as well as the audience. He prepares us for successive scenes, explains important events, comments on the behavior of the actors, and engages with both the actors and the audience. He condenses time by recalling the past that influenced the present situation. His story could be interrupted by the audience, by the players, as in the traditional African storytelling sessions. Next in importance to the storyteller is the audience, who become deeply involved in the performance. Early in the play itself, we see Anansi trying to involve the audience by asking them many questions. He asks for a simple solution for living his life. He says to the audience, "Brother, could it be you? Mother, how about you? Nobody?" So it is a collaborative activity from which both the performer and the audience derive equal benefit and pleasure. The audience joins in singing and sometimes makes comments. So this is another innovative technique that Sutherland added to the modern African theatre. The next important role that we look at is that of the players. All the actors except the key actors appear on the stage and do not wear costume as specific actors. They enter at the appropriate time to play their roles. They are used as actors when the time comes and go back to join the players. So they are also the participating audience. This is also the innovative technique that Sutherland uses in this play. Then we come to the property man. The property man is stationed on the stage. Usually he is hidden behind the stage, handing over the props to the actors. But contrary to this practice, Sutherland brings him on stage in full view of the audience. The property manager hands over the props to the actors in full view of the audience. So there is no illusion of reality. There is no confusion that something which is happening on the stage is real. So this is the technique that Sutherland uses to break the illusion of reality. In fact, the property man plays the role of a stage manager, and when he is free, he participates and responds to the players and the actors on the stage. Another very interesting and innovative feature that Sutherland has used in this play is the concept of Boggio. As I said, Boggio refers to the performance of songs. So the use of songs is an important aspect in the adaptation of the oral narrative for her dramatic art. The songs serve different purposes. They are used to take the story forward. They may be convenient pauses to provide transitions between situations. Sometimes the key actors start the song and the players join in. The songs also provide opportunity to the audience to participate in the performance. So Boggio may take other forms too, like a dance or a mime or a commentary. It could be even a scene, a play within a play. Another technique that Sutherland has used in this play is the concept of play within a play. For instance, the Akwasi and the Akosia episode is used to emphasize the fact that until the head drink is placed by a suitor for his prospective wife, he has no claim over her legally. Now, this is made very clear that Akosia is under no obligation to Akwasi despite accepting gifts from him. Similarly, Anansiva is under no obligation to any of the chiefs, and Anansi, who is well aware of this, exploits it and profits from the custom. So far, we looked at the play, The Marriage of Anansiva. Took a look at the characters and discussed some of the major themes and concerns in her play. Let us conclude this by looking at how Sutherland was received. What was the critical reception accorded to her? Sutherland's plays have received great critical acclaim for her innovative experiments of adapting ancient sources and theatrical techniques to modern drama. She used Ghanaian oral tradition as a tool for evolving an authentic Ghanaian theatre. Sutherland formed a community theatre in Ekamfi Atwian called Kodzaiden, which literally means story house, and a travelling performance group called Kusum Agoramba, and travelled around Ghana with her performance groups. Sutherland is admired for her commitment to taking theatre to remote villages. She is also known for the portrayal of women's roles in promoting social and political changes in Africa. In this module, we took a look at F.Y. Sutherland and her works, the themes and her contribution to the Ghanaian drama and culture, and the strong impact of dramatic art on contemporary African theatre. Next, we focused on her play, The Marriage of Anansiva, and provided an overview of the plot, summary, the major themes, characters, and the innovative techniques that she employs by combining the traditional and the modern to appeal to contemporary sensibilities. I hope you gained some insights into the African theatre and the play, The Marriage of Anansiva. For those who are interested in learning more about this, there are additional links available online for Anansi stories. Thank you.